all the time is, if I don't want to go to court, what can I do? What are my options?
Yeah, and I think that was excellently said by Georgia and so true. It's, you know, there is a huge desire by most clients to avoid that process, and it's certainly something we pride ourselves on doing. Look, I'm a lawyer, so I can litigate, and I will do that, and when it's necessary, it'll happen, and we're all very skilled at doing it. But our desire for all of our clients is to try and avoid that. Sometimes it's inevitable that a matter goes to court, and that might be because of an attractive dispute. It might be because there isn't a midpoint that can be reached, or it might be because of the personality type of your ex, that they're still quite hurting or they're angry. And you might have no option in that they're refusing to compromise within the range of what would be appropriate. But I would say that 80% of our clients avoid going to court. And they do that by way of either coming to us with an agreement that we help draft in the correct legal form that will formalise the process for them. And that can involve a variety of perks. For example, if one party is going to retain a piece of property, the correctly drafted documents will get them a stamp duty exemption, so you don't have to worry about stamp duty on the transfer of property. I also think it has the great benefit of allowing them to coexist, as you've mentioned, as parents. Or parents afterwards. There will be events, there will be birthday parties, there will be their children's weddings that they will be at. And the psychology tells us that children get through separations, and children aren't negatively affected by their parties separating, their parents separating. They're negatively affected by the conflict that exists with their parents separating. So if you're a parent who separate and you can coexist as much as is manageable, your children will generally be okay. But if your parents who have a high level of conflict at the point of your separation, that's when it can cause great distress for your children and their capabilities to be able to have a relationship with both of you or future relationships. The long-term effects can be enormous. So, like I said, about 80% of our clients really do attempt to finalize the documents, and that can happen in stages. It can be, I sat down with my partner, we've reached agreement, can you draw it up? And our level of involvement is minimal, and that really does minimise the legal fees for the client. It can be, look, I need your help to negotiate because I'm not comfortable doing it. We might say to them, look, that agreement actually isn't, we think, the best agreement for you. You're selling yourself short. You've not accounted for this and this, which the court would normally account for. And then they say, well, I've already agreed with my partner, so what can I do about that? Or I feel like I'm reneging on the situation, or, you know, what are my options? We're never here to talk anyone out of an agreement. We're here to advise you about what the effect of your agreement is so that you can make an informed decision. And there have been many times in our history where someone has said, well, look, I really appreciate your advice, but I'm comfortable in the decision I've made and I want to move forward, and we'll assist them as best we can. There have been many people who have come in and said, look, I had no idea all of that got counted. And had I known that got counted, you know, that makes complete sense to me now, because it's very hard to reach an agreement with someone when you don't know the premise of what gets considered for that agreement, to be fair. So education about the process is probably the first thing that parties get the greatest benefit from.